friends. Thank you for stopping in to watch another segment of A Heart After God Bible Teaching Ministry. And my name is Brad Abley, and I'm doing the teaching on the parable of the sower. This is actually part three of the parable of the sower. And you may notice that I'm wearing a beautiful African shirt. I'm not sure if this is limited specifically to Kenya or not, but on one of my last trips to Kenya, the pastors in Siaya bought this for me as a thank you gift, and I'm wearing it in honor of them. And again, just want to mention to the audience, I'm really looking to reach two segments, and that is, first and foremost, the teaching on the parables is to equip, to teach, and to train and to equip wonderful pastors in Siaya, Kenya, pastors and leaders in Siaya, Kenya, that Danny Gilbert and I are teaching and training. And specifically in this case, it's how to interpret the parables of Jesus, which, by the way, constitute one-third of all of his teaching. That's substantial. And the challenge that every Christian has is to learn principles of interpretation of those parables. And that's really the reason for my teaching. The other segment of people that I'm looking to reach is you. If you're not in Kenya, wherever you are, I'm looking to reach you and just develop in you a heart after God, a greater heart after God in and through his word. And so before I get into the teaching, let's have a word of prayer and ask the Holy Spirit to come and minister to us. In Luo, the phrase "come Holy Spirit" is "bi roho maler." And so we pray, "Come, Holy Spirit. You are our teacher. We ask you to lead us and guide us in all your truth, but help us also to partner with you to be wise and to use time-honored principles in studying and in interpreting your word. We pray now that you would form Christ in us as we study your word, that you would change us and transform us, and that we would hunger and thirst for you, Father, and that we would hunger and thirst for you with all of our hearts. And so we pray that you would prepare our hearts now to receive. And I ask you to help me to teach in the fear of God and with your accuracy and with the anointing of the Holy Spirit and the love of God. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. We left off last time in Matthew chapter 13, and I'm going to pick up and read Matthew 13, verses 18 through 23, and then in the notes we'll pick up on paragraph number 24. So Matthew chapter 13, and beginning in verse 18, reading out of the New American Standard, Jesus, in giving the explanation of the parable to his disciples, says, "Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it," and again, this Greek word doesn't mean that I don't get it. It means that they are not putting forth the effort to understand, that it is incumbent upon the listener to recognize the value of the word of God and make every effort to understand it. So it's not that they can't, it's that they won't. So he says, when anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, this is amazing. He says, the evil one, different name or title for Satan, comes and snatches away what has been sown in his heart. I probably mentioned before that he says the evil one comes, and this verb is a present tense verb, meaning that he comes and he comes and he comes and he comes and he comes. That is, he's relentless in what he's trying to do, and that is to snatch away what has been sown in his heart. You and I can be absolutely certain that there is great competition for the Word of God to get into our hearts and to grow. The Lord wants it to get into our hearts and produce enormous fruit. Satan wants to do everything he can from letting the word take root in us and then us growing. Think about this. If Satan understands the power of God's word and he does everything he can to snatch it away, should that not be a message to all of us to really hunger and thirst for God's word? By the way, I also mentioned in a previous teaching that the Greek word translated snatches, which is also in the present tense, is the same exact word that is used for the rapture of the church in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. That's remarkable. The Greek word snatch, harpazo, it refers to a violent catching up, a violent snatching. And so that Greek word picture gives us even more of an insight into what really is going on with the attempt to sow the word or to preach the word. So let's go back to Matthew 13. I just lost my place. Give me a moment to get there. All right. So he says, when anyone hears the word of the kingdom, remember this parable explains how the kingdom of God operates, and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what has been sown in his heart. This is the one, Jesus says, on whom seed was sown beside the road. The one, verse 20, the one on whom seed was sown on the rocky places. This is the man who hears the word. He hears and continues to hear, present tense. He hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Why with joy? Because he recognizes the life, how the word of God is life-giving. So he receives it with joy. He receives it with joy. Verse 21, yet he has no firm root in himself. Has, again, present tense. He has, and in an ongoing sense, no firm root in himself, but is only temporary. He's only temporary. And when, not if, but when affliction, that is tests and trials and difficulties, arises, affliction or persecution arises because of the word. Because of the word. The same word that can bless us can result in affliction or persecution. So he says, when affliction or persecution arises because of the word, immediately he falls away. Verse 22, and the one in whom seed was sown among the thorns, this is the man who hears the word, continually hears the word, and notice this, he says, Jesus, and the worry of the world and the deceitfulness of wealth or riches. Mark has the desire for other things, and Luke's parable has pleasures, just normal pleasures. They enter in and they choke the word, and it becomes unfruitful, unfruitful. Verse 23, the one on whom seed was sown on the good soil. This is the man who hears the word. This is the 15th time that Jesus has used that word hears in this parable. That tells us that is the main focus of the parable, and that is the condition of the hearer. He hears the word and understands it. Same Greek word that was used in verse 19. He puts forth effort to understand it, and not just understand it, but to live it out. Who understands it and who indeed bears fruit and brings forth continually some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. I'll tell you a quick story. When I was a brand new believer, one of the first sermons that I heard that I really can remember was from Psalm chapter 1. Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the path of sinners, or sit in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in, and the New American Standard translates it law, but the Hebrew word is Torah, which means teaching or instruction of Yahweh. And in his teaching or instruction, he meditates day and night. And so when I heard that, I can still remember after hearing the message, driving home and thinking and praying. He says he will be like a tree firmly planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither, but in whatever he does, he prospers. And I remember thinking to myself, could that really be me? Could I be a Psalm 1 man? And I'm quite sure, though I don't remember it specifically, I'm quite sure that the first time I read the parable of the sower, in my heart, I said, I really want to be in that 30, 60, and 100-fold category. Again, this is when I was a new believer way back in 1980, 1981. I wondered, and I prayerfully dialogued with God at the time and expressed my desire, and I knew it could happen, but you know, when you're just starting out in the Christian life, you don't understand everything. And I remember, this was several years ago, I was on a missions trip, and I had rented a car to go to my hotel. And I put a CD in the car. It was about a 30-minute drive to the hotel. And I began worshiping the Lord. And it was just one of those God moments where the Holy Spirit showed me how far He had taken me since I first gave my life to Him, and how much fruit had been produced in all those years. So this was, I think this was about 2006 or 2007, maybe it was 2008, somewhere in that area. And I was overwhelmed. It was like looking back over your life and kind of in a flash, and really grateful to God to allow me to see from His vantage point. Of course, when I say the word see from His vantage point, I'm not saying that I'm seeing it perfectly as He does, but I'm getting a glimpse. And I just was overwhelmed. I remember the tears started to flow and I had to pull off the side of the road because of gratitude, because of deep gratitude to God. And I think I said to myself, your word really does work. It really does work. And so for any of those of you out there, maybe you haven't been a Christian very long, trust me, when you sow the word of God in your heart and you guard your heart with all diligence, as Proverbs 4:23 says, you will produce an enormous amount of fruit. And so let me just stop and pray for those of you who are watching and just ask God's blessing on you. Father, I do ask your blessing upon those who are watching and listening, that you would encourage them that they can, working together with you, Holy Spirit, develop an extraordinary amount of fruit for you. And we pray that you would use your word to draw us closer to you. And so I just bless those who are watching and seeking to learn in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Now, if you'll turn with me in your notes, we're going to pick up on paragraph number 24. That's where we left off on the last teaching. I write here, the Greek word translated falls away, verse 21, is skandalizomai. Skandalizomai is probably the most accurate pronunciation for Greek. It can also mean to take offense at, and it's where our word scandalized comes from. The English word scandal or scandalized comes from. It means to take offense at. And it can also mean to fall away, of course. In paragraph number 25, the reality, beloved, is that when we take offense at God, when we're afflicted or when things don't go our way or when we suffer, we really need to take heed to the warning that is given to us in Proverbs 19:3, where it says, "The foolishness of man subverts his way. It undermines his way, and his heart rages against the Lord." That is, in our own foolishness, we get ourselves in trouble, and then instead of owning what we've done, owning our sin, we actually then berate God or blame God or accuse God. And I've done that in my own hardships and tests and trials and afflictions. I don't do it all the time. I'm not implying that, but I've been guilty of that. And it's painful to rail against God, to accuse Him when I'm at fault for my own sin or my own failures. He's not at fault. Now, in paragraph number 26, the third category of listeners that Jesus describes in verse 22, I've already mentioned that Mark adds the words, the desire for other things, Mark 4:19, and Luke has the important phrases, the pleasures of this life, and he uses the phrase, bring no fruit to maturity, in Luke chapter 8 and verse 14. And that leads me to paragraph number 27. Every human being, we all face the temptation to worry, don't we? In verse 22, back in Matthew 13, verse 22. God knows that, beloved, and that's why He has given us so many powerful promises in His Word to trust Him instead of worrying, so that our hearts can be protected from what I call worry's poison, or the poison of worry. And then in paragraph 28, I give you a number of examples that you can meditate on to combat worry. And one of my favorites is Isaiah 41, 8 through 10, which I committed to memory many, many, many years ago. And I have used this memory passage when I'm facing anxiety or when I'm facing worry, oh, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of times. And that's not an exaggeration. And it says, "You whom I have taken from the ends of the earth and called from its remotest parts and said to you, you are my servant. I have chosen you and not rejected you. Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not anxiously look about you, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Surely I will help you. Surely I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." And when I quote that, I just I meditate on it. I chew on it. I will turn it back to the Lord and say, "Thank you, Father, that you have said this to me, and I can claim this." And declaring the Word of God out loud, which is a part of biblical meditation, I don't know of anything more powerful that can change my circumstances than the Word of God. And this is all a part of getting the Word of God into our hearts and getting our hearts just working to create better soil, so to speak, in our hearts so that the Word can take root and be planted and grow. Now, next paragraph, number 29, the Greek word translated deceitfulness, that is relating to wealth in Matthew 13, 22, can also mean pleasures. You know, it's so easy, isn't it, to tell ourselves that the chief good in life is earning enough money so that we can enjoy the finer things of life. However, that kind of thinking for the believer can be deadly. The only chief good in life is a growing, deepening, abiding relationship with God. And loved ones, that is what makes life worth living. And that is what truly brings us joy. Psalm 16:11, "In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand, there are pleasures forevermore." Moving on to paragraph number 31, as we move toward the fourth category of hearers, and the conclusion of the parable in verse 23. Again, Matthew 13, verse 23. It will be well to keep in mind the context of our Lord's ministry. And that is that the parables serve to explain why it is that the good news of the kingdom meets with such varied response, as we've seen in chapters 11 and 12 of Matthew. From enthusiastic acceptance to just outright rejection. But the fault lies not in the message, but in those who receive it. That blank there in paragraph number 31 is receive it, those who receive it. By the way, I don't think I mentioned the blank in paragraph number 29, although my partner in ministry, Mark Biasotti, probably already got it. And again, thank you, Mark Biasotti, for doing all the editing and all the graphics work and being patient with me as well. I think that's the only blank that I forgot. So blank 29 in your notes is pleasures, and the blank at the end of the quote in paragraph 31 is receive it. Paragraph number 32 in your notes: moreover, we must catch what Jesus is teaching us about the nature of the kingdom in this age. In this age. And George Eldon Ladd explains yet again to us about the kingdom in Jesus' teaching. He writes, "This is the mystery of the kingdom, that the kingdom of God has come among men, and yet men can reject it." So God is not going to force those who belong to him and those who don't belong to him. He's not going to force them to obey him, but when they do, they enter into all that God has for them. Ladd goes on and says, it will not experience in this age, it will not experience uniform success. Not all will receive it. This was a staggering thing to one who knew only the Old Testament. In Old Testament teaching, when God's kingdom comes, it will come with power. Ladd writes, who can resist it? Who can withstand God? But precisely this is the mystery of the kingdom. The kingdom is here, but it can be rejected. One day, God will indeed manifest his mighty power to purge the earth of wickedness and sin and evil, but not now. God's kingdom is working among men, but God will not compel them to bow before it. Again, in this age, they must receive it. The response must come from a willing heart and a submissive will. That's what keeps the soil of our hearts good, so that the word of God can be planted, take root, and grow. Paragraph 33 in your notes, the disciples must also understand one further critical teaching from Jesus in this parable, which Ladd again articulates in writing: God will not drive you into his kingdom. It is not the business of those who are called to the ministry of the word to speak, watch this, with authoritarian compulsion. And yet that's what so many ministers do. And loved ones in Kenya, I know that that has been a lament on your part, that you've grown up in the church and seen these self-proclaimed apostles and prophets and bishops who are authoritarian. There's a difference between being authoritative and authoritarian. Authoritarian is, you don't question me. And if you do question me, I question your salvation. Or if you do question me, you're touching God's anointed. Or if you do question me, I'm kicking you out of my church. Those kind of things. That is authoritarianism, and that is not Jesus. That's not the heart of Jesus Christ, nor is it the heart of his apostles. The true heart of God is to have a shepherd's heart and to care for people and draw them into the things of God, not in a weak way, in an authoritative way. But anybody that carries authority as a minister of the gospel better be humble. and better have a God's heart for his people, because if he doesn't and he moves in authority, people are not going to respond. People are not going to follow him. But if we move in love, if we move in humility, if we've been faithful to pray for the people and then we move in authority, they'll, generally speaking, they will respond. They want us to move in authority. Those of us who are called to pulpit ministry, they don't want us to be weak. But boy, it takes a lot of dependence upon God, doesn't it? So Ladd goes on and he says, we speak as emissaries of God. But I like this. But we plead and do not demand. We persuade and we do not drive. We implore men to open their hearts that the word of his kingdom may have its fruitage in their lives. But men can reject it. They can spurn the gospel of the kingdom. They can scorn the preacher of the word, and he is helpless. That's the way it is in our society. That doesn't mean that the preacher doesn't respond back. You know, the church in Corinth, many of the Corinthians accused Paul of not being sincere, not being genuine, and false apostles had come into the church and questioned his authenticity and his credibility. And Paul wrote 2 Corinthians to combat these things. And in some cases, Paul used some real godly irony and even a little bit of godly sarcasm. So it's not that we just become doormats where we let people walk over us. We stand firm in authority. But again, I reiterate, we have to move in love and in humility. Well, let's move on to paragraph number 34 in the notes. It is the fourth category of listeners that the man or woman ought to desire to attain to. Also, I write, we must consider the significance of the word hear. In verse 23, and as I mentioned earlier, now mentioned for the 15th time in this parable. Now, paragraph 35, Jesus commends those who not only hear, but do the word of God. And as a result, they bear great fruit in their lives. Go back to verse 12, where Jesus says, for whoever has, to him more shall be given, and he will have an abundance. But whoever does not have, even what he has will be taken away from him. And I mentioned in the teaching when we were in that, I think it was probably parables part two, it's not that God takes away, it's really a law of use. That is, it's a Hebrew figure of speech saying, if you don't use what you've been given, you're going to lose it. And taken away from him is a, what's the word I'm looking for? It's a, I was going to say euphemism. It's not a euphemism. That'll come back to me. But it's a figure of speech basically saying that you're going to lose it. That's how the Jewish people who were listening to him would have taken that. So next sentence under paragraph 35, these indeed are the very people who are so grateful to be included in the kingdom that with submissive heart they choose to honor the king. And I probably should mention there, choose to honor the words of the king. Consequently, paragraph 36, they walk in the destiny that God has for them, becoming rich toward him, which is exactly what Jesus wants. He wants us to be rich towards God. And I've given you some very, very good biblical references for what I've just said there. Paragraph number 37, John MacArthur writes of this 160 and 30-fold return, which again equals 10,000%, 6,000%, and 3,000% respectively. He writes, believers differ in fruit bearing because they differ in commitment to obedience. That blank there in paragraph number 37 is they differ in commitment to obedience. but all are profusely fruitful. Now, we ask the question in paragraph 38, was Jesus speaking metaphorically of this extraordinary return, or was he speaking literally with a spiritual application? Well, another New Testament scholar, Robert Gundry, points out that such a harvest in those days in the land of Israel was literally possible, and that a hundredfold return was indeed considered to be an excellent, though not fantastic, yield. And I think by the word fantastic, he means unrealistic. That's how I take it. Well, that leads us to paragraph number 40 in Luke's equivalent of verse 23, which is Luke 8:15. He adds that this fourth category of hearers bear fruit with perseverance. Boy, that phrase really struck me a couple days ago as I was doing some further studying in the parable of the sower. They bear fruit with perseverance. I'm so glad that Luke included those words. Of these words, Darrell Bach, in his commentary on Luke, gives us added insight. He writes, fruit is never a matter of an overnight exercise. It takes nurturing. Thus, Jesus' teaching does not look at the reaction to God's word in a single moment, but over a period of time. That blank there, the word is period. They look at the, let me read that sentence again. Thus, Jesus' teaching does not look at the reaction to God's word in a single moment, but over a period of time. You remember I just gave you that example a little bit earlier about how I felt like the Holy Spirit just suddenly showed me how much fruit that I've been privileged to bear over the course of my 30, that is now 35 plus years of being a Christian. And you know, that time goes by so fast, and one day you look back at your life and you're overwhelmed with the amount of fruit that comes forth. Now, don't think that, well, he's a minister, of course he should bear that kind of fruit, which is true. But I'm bearing that kind of fruit because I'm a hungry Christian. I want to please God. I want to honor him. I do take his word seriously. And it is and was an incredible joy for him to give me an insight into just how much the word of God has produced, how much fruit that the word of God has produced. I'm not special. God is no respecter of persons. But it is the reason that I almost every night pray before going to sleep, Father, help me to hunger and thirst for you and seek you and search for you with all my heart tomorrow morning. And I often will pray that in the morning as well. Well, let me finish this excellent quote from Darrell Bach. He goes on and says, the parable looks at a career of response, that is a life of response, as is clear when one considers that the good soil brings up various levels of fruit. The assessment is built on moments, to be sure, but it requires a life of response to consider what one's soul looks like relative to a slowly developing crop. A plant does not sprout forth overnight, nor does the harvest of the heart. Excellent, just excellent. You know, it's true. We need to persevere with the Word of God because of affliction, because of tests and trials, and disappointment with God and heartache with God. There have been many times in my life where I just, you know, I was tempted to just walk away from God and turn away and quote unquote chuck the whole thing away. But I always remember Peter's words when Jesus said to Peter, do you want to go away also, Peter? And Peter said, Lord, you have the words of eternal life. Where else would we go? So I walk away from the Lord. Really, I'm going to be better off walking away from the Lord than all my time with him. That's absurd, and I know that. But there's a spiritual attack coming against me. The devil is trying to accuse me against God. And by his grace, I continue to persevere. But even in the persevering, we grow. That's perseverance brings fruit as well. But I'm just glad that Jesus tells us up front that in order to bear fruit, he says, loved ones, you are going to have to hear with perseverance. You're going to have to bear fruit with perseverance. So paragraph 41, indeed, the Greek word translated perseverance in Luke 8:15 lends us an insight into the reality of the Christian faith. Our growth will come with tests, trials, afflictions, challenges, difficulties, and so on. That leads me to paragraph number 42. This Greek word is pronounced hupomone. Hupomone. The idea hupo is to remain or to be under. And mone comes from menain, the Greek word, which means to remain under. And in my opinion, as a student of the Greek language of the New Testament, hupomone, and it appears a lot in the New Testament, is easily one of the most important words in the entire New Testament. So it's my joy to give you its rich definition. Paragraph 43, in this extremely rich word, it is an extremely rich word, that means to endure, it means to hold out, it means to stand firm or put up with. That's not all. Paragraph 47, it is a patient endurance. It's a patient waiting and hope for God. And this quality derives from faith and hope in Romans 8:25. As a result, we're not done with this definition. It's deep. As a result, paragraph 45, it is never a complaining or despondent endurance. Kind of we hang our head and say, all right, well, I'll just endure. That's not what the word means. In fact, in classical Greek language of the time of the New Testament, this word was used of that quality which enabled a man to die for his God. By the way, that word complaining, the blank there in paragraph 45 is complaining. Let me just read that definition again. As a result, this is paragraph 45, it is never a complaining or despondent endurance. In fact, in classical Greek, this word was used of that quality which enabled a man to die for his God. Paragraph 46, even more helpful, it is the spirit which bears things, not simply with resignation. All right, I'll bear it. That's not it at all, but with blazing hope. That blank there in paragraph 46 is blazing hope. It is the spirit which bears things because it knows that these things are leading to a goal of glory. Now that's a lot, isn't it? There's a lot there in the definition of just one word. To summarize it, when I have to pull out by the grace of God, that hupomone, that patient endurance, I often think, I put it to myself this way, it's the Jesus kind of patience. Hupomone is the Jesus kind of patience. And the Jesus kind of patience will go to the Garden of Gethsemane and cry out, Father, if possible, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. And then he went to the cross. That is hupomone. That's the best example of all of hupomone. And so I often, when I pray and I say, Father, help me to move. I'll just say, help me to move in the Jesus kind of endurance. And that's the highest form of endurance of all. I'm going to drink a little bit of tea here. Maybe you're watching with some tea or coffee. Paragraph 47 in your notes. I ask you the question, beloved, What adjustments must you make in your life in order to keep in step with God and continually develop His fruit for the remainder of your life? In paragraph 48, let us keep in mind that in bearing fruit for Him, we bring glory to Him, we partner with Him to influence others for Him, one person at a time and one day at a time. Let me also just mention that bringing forth fruit for God is very high on His list. But in the process of bringing forth that fruit, it's all about relationship with Him. We're not His workers. We're not His slaves. Yes, we're His servants, but Jesus also calls us friend. And so this is also about relationship. That is, when we grow through the Word of God, it's so that we might have a closer relationship with Him. Well, paragraph 49, let us consider one more aspect of our need to bear fruit through how we handle the hearing of God's Word, particularly the difference between the third and fourth category of hearers. The difference, Bach writes, seems to be the condition of the heart. He writes, a healthy heart clings to God's Word. That word, that blank there, is clings. It beats fast for Him and responds to Him. A damaged heart has trouble seeing Him over the distraction and attraction to other things. And John warns us in 1 John 2, do not love the world, nor the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the boastful pride of life is not from the Father, but from the world, and the world is passing away. Well, let me go back to finish this quote from Bach. He says, it does take constant listening and clinging to the Word to be fruitful. To respond to God is not a matter of spiritual cruise control. And for my beloved brothers and sisters in Kenya, cruise control is some of the modern cars. You probably already know this, but just mentioning this, some of the modern cars, at least in our freeways, where you can go very fast, you put it on cruise control and you don't have to keep your foot on the pedal. You just sit back and relax. So he says, to respond to God is not a matter of spiritual cruise control, where things happen automatically in instinctive response to the things of God. He adds, it takes conscious effort, that blank there, effort, to focus on God and His ways so that we become consistently fruitful. And in paragraph 50, only Luke notes the words, in an honest and good heart. I love that. They bear fruit with perseverance in an honest and good heart. The word honest can mean honorable or better. In addition, it can be translated beautiful or precious. Precious as in unique or valuable or rare. Paragraph 51, the exhortation from Solomon in Proverbs 4:23 about guarding our heart with all diligence certainly comes to mind, because how can the Word of God grow in a corrupted heart? That's what Jesus is teaching us. And then in paragraph 52, the word good in Luke 8:15 can actually mean fertile. Isn't that interesting? When used of soil. But in a moral sense, it means to be upright or clear of conscience. And it's out of that kind of heart, paragraph 53, continually kept right before God and for God, that one really develops fruit that can grow exponentially and that is of eternal value. But once again, paragraph 54, even an individual like this one will need to have perseverance, hupomone, and respond to the Word by holding it fast, Luke 8:15. Again, fellow men and women of God, saints in Christ Jesus, holy ones in Christ Jesus, let's remember the ferocity with which Satan comes against the word to steal it out of the heart of an individual. Just mark it down that every time you're ready to study the Word of God or hear the Word of God preached, he is going to compete with that word preached and try to steal it from our hearts. This kind of believer, paragraph 55, is clearly sold out to Jesus. He or she puts him and his word first, and nothing else can ever take his place. Nothing else can ever take the place of his word. In Psalm 138, I think it's verse 2, in the New Living Translation, it says, "You have exalted above all else your name and your word." Finally, paragraph 56, let us soberly think of how we view the Word of God, which Jesus has abundantly made clear is to be held with the highest regard and the most earnest pursuit. Paragraph 57, first, we must continually keep in mind that it is the Word of God. There's only one Word of God, and it is the Word of God. Secondly, paragraph 58, it is the Word of God. It is spoken to us. It must be handled wisely, accurately, and humbly, because it is his own communication with us. 2 Timothy 2:15. Paragraph 59, third, it is God's word, or it is the Word of God. It is God's word. Accordingly, it is never, never under any circumstances ours to trifle with. Yet that's precisely what far too many Christians do. For those of us who have the privilege and the awesome responsibility to handle the Word of God accurately, oh, may the Lord bring greater fear of Him in our hearts to not only handle the Word accurately, but to also preach it accurately as well. I'm looking out the window here because I see two what we call mourning doves, and my wife and I have long called them Holy Spirit doves. And I'll tell you, for probably 20, 25 years now, every time I see those doves, it reminds me of the presence of the Holy Spirit. And so unexpectedly, they just flew here outside of my window on the windowsill. I'm up above second floor, and they're looking at me right now. And it's just a reminder of a gentle reminder of the presence of the Holy Spirit with me. I'm almost tempted to turn the camera so you can see those guys, but I'm not going to do that. You'll have to trust me that they're there. And why do I say that? Because one of the symbols of the Holy Spirit is a dove. And it just, he's so gentle, just like those birds. I'm laughing because they're looking right in the window. Hello, little Holy Spirit doves. You stay there and just enjoy yourselves. All right, now that I've gotten a little bit too silly, I need to get back to it. Paragraph 60, no matter how compelling or popular any teacher of God's word may be, what he or she teaches must faithfully and continually be examined to see if it contradicts God's word. Think about it, loved ones. Every single Christian who has ever lived will be held accountable with how we treated God's word and by what we did with his word. And that is sobering, isn't it? Paragraph 62, but if we're faithful to that word, we can also be certain that our Father will reward us openly and richly. And praise God, that concludes our teaching on the parable of the sower. And next time I will be getting into the parable of the weeds, the wheat and the tares, I believe it is. So I look forward to doing that teaching coming up soon. Let me see if I can turn this. No, I don't want to turn the cameras to show the bird, but I just want you to get a chance to see that Holy Spirit dove. All right. Well, let me close in prayer and just remind you to ask God on a daily basis. Ask Him on a daily basis. Father, help me to hunger and thirst for You and for Your Word. Help me to seek You and search for You with all of my heart. And beloved, is that a prayer that God wants to answer? You know it's a prayer that He wants to answer, but you and I have to exercise that great spiritual discipline of carving out time to spend with God in prayer, in His Word, and I would even add in worship as well. Well, I hope that you will tell others about this teaching ministry. I hope that you'll even consider giving financially to this teaching ministry. I make my living by the gospel. And so you can go to my website, pastorbradabley.weebly.com. Well, you're already there, of course. And then you can just click on the contact section and give your best gift. Give generously to this work. I'm doing this for free. I'm not being paid by anybody. And it's not easy for me to make an appeal to give. It's just never been easy for me to do that. I suppose because there's so many preachers who have abused their call, just their appeal. And I don't do that. I don't want to do that. But nevertheless, as my wife reminds me, a workman is worthy of his wages. So pray about it. All right? Let me close in prayer. Father, thank You for this time in the Word with Your fellow servants, Your fellow sons and daughters. And now I'm just going to pronounce one of my favorite benedictions over you, beloved. And may the Lord bless you and keep you. And may the Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you His peace, both now and forevermore, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you might abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you. Look forward to seeing you next time.